It's Eric Giles. I serve as the program director for the National Indian Carbon Coalition. And the NIC program is a joint venture of the Indian Land Tenure Foundation and the Intertribal Agriculture Council. And it began around 2011. And we've been up and running. And we started out doing a lot of outreach and education on carbon sequestration and the development of carbon markets and trying to encourage tribal participation in carbon markets. So a lot of the mission of the NIC program is focused around agriculture and rangeland management. We also are involved with forestry management projects as well. And the concept of the carbon sequestration and managing for carbon sequestration, either removal from the atmosphere or reducing the amount of carbon dioxide emissions from an area. It really centers on a land conservation management program that looks at managing for carbon. And this concept is developed, it's called carbon farming. And so that's where you're implementing practices within the defined project area that have the benefit of, as I said, reducing the amount of carbon dioxide emissions from a site or enhancing the carbon storage capacity of the site. So project type example would be grassland restoration of an area that used to be pasture and implementing a project that restores grassland will increase the capacity of that land to sequester carbon dioxide. And there's other project types that you can see through these greenhouse gas management practices. One that we've been looking at in one of our Conservation Innovation Grant pilot project areas is mulching and composting application on defined rangeland sites. And then other ones, such as nutrient management, that's the efficient application of fertilizer and reducing the amount of nitrous oxide that leaves cropland. That can be achieved through efficiency controls or through no-till conservation on cropland. Other areas that can be looked at is helping to prevent wind erosion on croplands by establishing shelter belts or windbreaks. And then it also what they call afforestation and taking degraded agriculture lands and restoring them through tree planting projects or conservation cover restoration. So what the outcome of these projects is you're restoring vegetated cover on the landscape, or you're implementing a new management system that is reducing nitrous oxide emissions, or just an overall reduction in greenhouse gas management emissions, or enhancing the capacity. And when you implement those treatment systems in these project sites, you can quantify the amount of carbon that you're either saving or you're removing. And that translates into what the metric is one metric ton of carbon dioxide. You can quantify that amount, and you can come up for how many metric tons you're reducing or you're enhancing the savings in that site for. That quantified amount then can be transferred into a market. where you'll have buyers will purchase that amount that you're saving. And that is what the carbon markets are about, is you'll have companies or individual entities that have measured their greenhouse gas output, and they are taking internal reductions of their greenhouse gas emissions, and then there might be a gap in that reduction that they'll cover with the purchase of carbon credits. So we want to be able to take what tribes or allottee associations or Indian agriculture producer associations, we can take those different conservation practices, implement them on agricultural rangeland land, and then be able to measure and develop the amount of carbon credits that are being created, and then have them sold on a market so that buyers are purchasing and investing on Indian lands, and then tribes or individual Indians are managing their lands that are reducing greenhouse gas emissions, but they're also producing environmental co-benefits. So for instance, in a riparian area, they might fence off that riparian zone and let the vegetated cover restore itself. And then out of that, they're able to enhance the water quality of that area, reduce the amount of soil erosion, and then just create a better functioning ecosystem for those areas. But we want to be able to translate these carbon farming management practices into the voluntary carbon market rules and protocols. And so the carbon markets themselves have developed kind of project standards that make these management practices eligible to sell credits on. And so you can see on the voluntary carbon market protocols, they have ones looking at fertilizer management, grazing land and livestock management, grassland management, soil amendments, and then avoided conversions of grassland and shrubland. That's not a comprehensive list of all the different protocols that are out there on the market, but these are the ones that we've been focusing on for our CIG project. So this management practice in particular is the soil amendment application, and it's utilizing compost on grazed rangeland. And we've partnered with an entity called the Carbon Cycle Institute, and they developed a pilot project area in Marin County, California, where they put this compost treatment on a project area. And what they were able to show is just through a 1-inch or 1/2-inch application of compost, the result was enhanced plant growth and grassland growth. But in another benefit was the increased carbon sequestration. And it just, they had a control area where they didn't apply the compost regime, and the sequestration rate of carbon in the area that received the treatment was just off the charts. And it also produced soil moisture, water retention benefits for that soil. So you can see that just through this one-time application, there are a lot of different environmental benefits that were being produced in this area. In addition, it didn't place any constraints on the landowner in terms of management. You know, the cows are still, going out and grazing those areas that had received the compost treatment. And what Marin County, they formed an aggregation program of a bunch of different ranchers, and they used this treatment on their land. And you can see that through this treatment, you know, they can have a lot of applications in areas that can be impacted by drought conditions, particularly the soil moisture retention. So back to the kind of the mission of the NIC program, you know, we're looking at implementing carbon farming management practices, and it grew out of a pilot project that we were a part of, where the Indian Land Tenure Foundation was a part of, and the Intertribal Agriculture Council was a part of back in 2008 with the Fort Peck Landowners Association on the Fort Peck Reservation in Montana. Developing carbon projects based on soil carbon offset. An entity called the Chicago Climate Exchange. So that there is a forecasted value of some of these credits going up to about work in partnership with the tribe itself. in country. Been projects done in the past and try to purchase. During this project development cycle, there was a lot of different issues that came up. In working with the allotment that led to the landowner. Challenges. Had a hand in how manage. The tribe itself. The land station. In particular, the most constraining factor with the traction nation. Wanted to be enrolled in a carbon contract. The agency stated that they had to go through the rule of getting consent of the majority of landowners to agree to that contract, and that required, you know, in some cases of these allotments, as you know probably 50 to 100 fractionated interest holders. And so that hurdle just raised the cost of doing business, and ultimately the Landowners Association withdrew from the project. There was also the case of education amongst the agencies, trying to understand what is carbon. Is it an element? Is it a mineral resource? And if it's a mineral resource, then it would be a trust asset, and so then it would have to go through all the hurdles of utilizing trust assets. But those are some of the project development challenges that came about this. And the tribe ended up moving forward in 2008 and registering and certifying its own project. So after that experience in the Fort Peck region, Indian Land Tenure and the Intertribal Agriculture Council came together to form the NIC program. And the mission of our area has been focused on prairie grassland ecosystems. And what we're looking to address primarily is not only environmental issues caused by greenhouse gases, but also the land tenure issues in these areas, and looking at fractionated ownership of land and partnership with tribal trust land, the different types of land, of Indian land ownership, of their individual trust allotments, restricted fee allotments, public domain allotments, and being able to take these areas and bring them into a project so that we're beginning to generate economic development revenue for off of these lands, but also increasing the environmental quality and the environmental output of these lands as well. So as we did a lot of the education and outreach, we began to form those connections and develop networks with professionals in the field of agriculture, ecosystem services, and buffalo management, and as well as a carbon market registry as well. And we decided to apply for a Conservation Innovation Grant, and it was designed to be a 3-year collaboration for a total of about $600,000. And there was, in the budget, we have $300,000 coming from the federal and another $300,000 as a match. A large part of the matches are coming from in-kind contributions from some of the tribal participants and some of the the nonprofit entities. You can see with the obviously there's us, the National Indian Carbon Coalition. Then we have the Spatial Informatics Group and Natural Assets Laboratory, which is a nonprofit entity that works on ecosystem management and development. They've developed a number of carbon projects and verified those projects and had them for woman registry. The Intertribal Buffalo Council became involved because we have one of our project sites that we're looking at in our CIG is Peshawar land. That's an area in the Black Hills that has been reacquired by a partnership of Sioux tribes. And the American Carbon Registry, which is one of these, as you call them, essentially a bank for carbon credits. And they're interested in looking at the development of market rules to be specific to Indian country and also being able to inform investors and purchasers of credits about the land tenure systems in Indian country. The carbon cycle is, too, I mentioned, was the ones that pioneered the carbon farming protocol and the soil amendment composting application regime. And then our three partner tribes that we have now is the Comanche Nation, the Lower Rural Sioux Tribe, and the Santa Ana Pueblo. We have project objectives that we went through and developed to comply with the requirements of the CIG. And what we really wanted to be able to develop was clear guidance on how to develop projects on Indian land. And that's where the American Carbon Registry volunteered to participate with us. That was also one of the criteria for the application and evaluating our application was looking at developing greenhouse gas market protocols and actually working with one of these carbon registry. We want to be able to adapt existing methodologies to new areas, and that is a part of our project with the Santa Ana Pueblo, and the implementing of compost and soil amendment on some of their rangeland. That methodology worked great in Marin County. Marin County is in Northern California with a totally different climate and landscape. And we wanted to see how it's going to work in a southwestern area that has much more drought conditions and environmental impacts, and so we see test out this methodology to see how it will work. We recently just finished our first site visit out there to Santa Ana, and we're located outside of Albuquerque, and it was a really interesting visit to be a part of. We worked with the natural resources staff, presented on the markets and where prices are, but then we spent a large time of the day doing site visits and driving around all the different rangeland sites that they had in mind for this project. The land tenure system will also come into play there as well, because it's not just an area that's being under either tribal trust land or allotments. The whole pueblo is owned by the tribe under tribal ownership, and so ag producers or rangeland management activities are done by an assignment. And so we have to take into account how those assignments are going to work in developing the carbon contracts. I've touched on the pilot projects, and we want to be able to develop carbon offsets from four different pilot project sites, and that includes the Comanche and the Peshlaw lands, and Santa Ana Pueblo and the Lower Brule. And in those pilot project sites, we have an idea to just adapt the project types to the to the goals of those tribes, and then also to what will be appropriate to their management system. So the Santa Ana is really under this initiative of composting, and they want to work with the within their own tribe, but also trying to develop a kind of a regional composting facility with the county, and so the soil amendment methodology was a priority for them. When we go out to Comanche later this month, they're interested in the whole gamut of different carbon farming management techniques. They have areas identified for no-till conservation. They want to look at establishing wind and shelter belt areas on adjacent to croplands, grazing land and livestock management systems for their buffalo herds, and then that's in the same situation with the Lower Brule. They want to look at a whole range of different activities to develop projects off of. And then in the Peshlaw lands, it's really more of a grassland restoration activity, and trying to adapt that area with a compatible stocking unit for buffalo, while in concert with grassland restoration. Another difference amongst these pilot projects is the land base, and for Santa Ana, we're looking at a very specific area addressing the land, and then in Comanche, they have hundreds of thousands of acres, but they have a lot of allotted lands and tribal trust lands, and so it's not all contiguous. So there's a big checkerboard pattern in Comanche. And then out on the Lower Brule, obviously you're dealing with tribal trust allotments, but also individual allotments with highly fractionated interest. So that the land project guidance, I mentioned, it's trying to create a comprehensive document to show what is the full range of different land tenure systems in Indian country, and how do contracts and market transactions work on these different land tenure statuses. They also have implications for how carbon projects will meet certain thresholds to become eligible to sell credits on. So if there are rangeland surveys that are done on certain tribal trust lands, if they have measured stocking units for how much grazing activity can take place on those lands, that implicates what the baseline level of activities there are going to be. And for developing a carbon project, your management system has to produce amount of a rate of carbon sequestration that goes above the baseline level. So we have to really be careful about what federal land management practices that are being required of tribes to implement on the ground, how that is going to affect meeting these different carbon project thresholds. I mentioned also, in the Fort Peck project, one of the constraints on that was the highly fractionated interest of individual allotments. And so we really want to be able to know how to work around fractionated interest and what federal rules or what tribal laws are in place that the tribe can, so that they can actually work on behalf of the landowners and those fractionated interests. So these are the four project areas that we had in mind, and you can see what the different project types we have designated for those. So our timeline for what we're hoping to achieve, we started drafting the guidance document, working in coordination with the American Carbon Registry. That document will also be available. We want to be able to include as much stakeholder interest as possible, so we want to include as many tribes and get as much input as possible from tribes and LATI associations or the BIA and USDA to really nail down what are all the federal rules that are going to apply, and then what tribal laws can be put in place that help facilitate development of projects. We've been already this year has gone by. We've been already looking at identifying different parcels to create pilot project areas, and that'll be ongoing production. We just completed our Santa Ana site visit. We have the Comanche tribe coming up at the end of the month, and we'll be visiting the Lower Brule this summer as well. And so by next year, we want to be able to have the project development piece in place. So we want to be able to come up with a management system that's going to be applicable to the tribes, and that it's going to be quantifying a certain amount of credit that can be produced under a specific carbon market protocol. And then we ultimately want to be able to transact and